and also the relationship of stress in both. And I will focus on the one hand on schizophrenia and on the other hand on depression, because we did several studies both in schizophrenia and in depression regarding the immune system. These are my disclosures, and you have in the meantime already heard a lot about stress and important factors. I don't want to go here into more details. You know that there are different kind of stress, and both the personality and also the coping mechanisms play a role, how you feel the stress and how stressful is the distress or the eustress. There's already an old literature showing the relationship between stress and several types of infection. Already in the 1980s was described that, for example, physical and psychic stress determines the clinical strength and also the neurotropy of viral diseases. Stress influences the antibody titers and also the exacerbation and the course of viral diseases, for example, of herpes infection, but also these are only examples. And of course, all the stress suppresses the immune response, suppresses, for example, antibody titers of neurotropic viruses, and in autoimmune disorders, we know that stress plays a role in relation to the exacerbation and also the cause of several autoimmune disorders. And on the relationship between infections and psychosis, already Kraepelin described in 1890 the relationship of influenza, and in Germany we currently have an influenza wave, the relationship between influenza and psychosis, and without doubt there is a strong relationship between the immune system infection and psychosis. There are a lot of findings in the meantime pointing this out. For example, we know that there's an increased risk for schizophrenia after a meningitis epidemic. A role plays the increased risk after infection of the pregnant mother, but not only of the pregnant mother, also during the development of the brain in the first years of in the first years of age, for example, there's a fivefold risk for schizophrenia. And in relation to the immune system, there were found increased levels of a pro-inflammatory component of the cytokine interleukin 8, and these levels predict an increased risk for schizophrenia in the offspring if the mothers had enlarged levels during the second trimenon. And there are some further arguments. I cannot go into all details due to the limited time. Some years ago, we published a study about the relationship of titers of infectious agents and schizophrenia, and we measured different infections components like chlamydia trachomatis, toxoplasma, Epstein-Barr virus, and herpes virus, but we did not find a significant relationship for one certain infectious agent. But what we found was when we build a so-called susceptibility index, that patients with schizophrenia had a tendency to more positive titers against different infectious agents. That means not a certain infectious agent, not a certain pathogen seems to play the crucial role, but the fact that there is an infection and there is an immune response to this infectious agents. And regarding different animal models, this has been proven during the last years by several groups. For example, using the agent poly-IC, which mimics a viral infection, but more or less the same results have also been found using the lipopolysaccharides, which mimic a bacterial infection. That means in these animal models, both a viral infection and a bacterial infection leads to these, let me say, schizophrenic symptoms in the animal models. And interestingly, these symptoms can be reversed, for example, by clozapine and also the cognitive deficits associated with this immune response can be reversed by clozapine or also other antipsychotics. So that means on the one hand, the prenatal immune activation plays a role, but interestingly, there was one publication 2 years ago in Science showing that another additional factor, that means stress during adolescence and especially during puberty, is another factor which also plays a role combined with the prenatal immune activation. So the prenatal immune activation increases the vulnerability for stress-induced changes of the central nervous system during puberty. And this is related to the immune response. And especially the microglia cells in the brain, because we know that these types of cells are, let me say, the immune cells or part of the immune system in the brain. And if the microglia is activated, then they create an immune response, for example, with different cytokines, and especially also with PET, with positron emission tomography markers, there has been shown that in schizophrenia there's an increased activation of the microglia. This has been shown by different groups and also by different PET markers. Regarding or coming back to the immune system, we know that stress also is a factor that primes the immune system, that conditions the immune system. For example, we know that a lot of different factors such as neurodegeneration, aging, stress are able to prime the microglia cells, and priming means that the second stimulus, for example, a systemic inflammation, leads to a microglia proliferation and due to this priming to an increased production and to an increased release of these pro-inflammatory cytokines, and it facilitates the re-exacerbation of an inflammatory pathology in the central nervous system. And on this basis, we think that you all know the vulnerability stress hypothesis of schizophrenia, but we think that inflammation and the stress leading to inflammation is an important additional factor, we know that the pro-inflammatory immune state of the mother, perhaps also on the basis of a genetic vulnerability, plays a role, but if there's an inflammation and if there's, for example, additional stress, then there is a vicious circle on the basis of the immune sensitization and on the basis of the immune, of the priming of the immune system, leading, of course, to the, at the end, to the dopaminergic overactivity and also to an antagonism of the glutamatergic neurotransmission. We did several studies with anti-inflammatory medication, especially with the cyclooxygenase 2 inhibitors in schizophrenia. Due to time, I cannot go into details here. I just want to show a meta-analysis which has been published 3 years ago now, showing that these COX-2 inhibitors have significant positive effects both on the schizophrenic positive symptoms but also on schizophrenic negative symptoms and on the total scale. And 2 years ago, there has been published a second meta-analysis showing more or less showing more or less the same results, and especially in early stages of schizophrenia, those anti-inflammatory medication has an impact on the benefit of schizophrenic symptoms. Now let me change to the major depression. Of course, you have already heard today that there is a relationship also with depression and the immune system, and you know that the C-reactive protein is one of the most widespread markers of an inflammation in total. And there are a lot of findings in the meantime showing that also the CRP is enlarged in depressed patients. We know that CRP is also related, for example, to the body mass index, that it increases with age and with other factors. But even if you control for all these well-known factors for increase of the CRP, you find in depressed patients an increase of this inflammatory markers. And for example, just one finding is in our hospital that we found a significant correlation of the increased CRP levels and the severity of depression. And we think that also this increase of the pro-inflammatory immune state in depression is also stress mediated. Of course, we know that stress induces an increase of several pro-inflammatory cytokines. And also here we see a sensitization or priming of the pro-inflammatory cytokines, possibly an imbalance between different types of cells in the CNS. Microglia and astrocytes plays a role here, but it's not very well studied yet. What it better studied is that early life stress is associated also with an increased pro-inflammatory cytokine responsiveness and also with an increased risk of depression. There are several studies in the early 2000s which have been published in the meantime, just mentioning that the relationship between early childhood stress inflammatory markers and the depression in adult patients, and also the inflammatory responsiveness to stress, especially in patients with early life stress. And therefore, also in depression, we follow this kind of vulnerability stress inflammation hypothesis, also leading to this vicious cycling of the conditioned or primed immune response, possibly during early childhood already, but for example, and re-exacerbation, of course, during other states of the immune activation, leading in the consequence to a lack of the serotonergic neurotransmission, and also is related to the glutamatergic neurotransmission. I will come back later a bit to this. I will show you now some data of one study which was just finished some months ago, a study in patients and controls on the relationship between stress, depression, and inflammation. And all patients fulfilled these two stress lists, the list of threatening experiences, LTEQ list, the perceived stress scale, which is related to the last week, stress during the last week, the other one related to stress during the last year, and also the childhood trauma questionnaire. And we measured different cytokines and also other markers of inflammation. The first, of course, was of the results that we found higher scores of this LTE questionnaire and also on the PSS in depressed patients, significantly higher scores. That means the depressed patients experienced more stress acutely during the last week, but also during the last year. And the depressed patients also show higher scores on these childhood trauma questionnaires compared to controls, especially regarding this subscale physical neglect. And there's a tendency also to significance in the other subscales, sexual abuse and emotional neglect. But what has this to do with the inflammation? The depressed patients compared to controls showed also significantly higher levels of interleukin-6, which is also a cytokine, a pro-inflammatory cytokine, but also higher levels of the interleukin-10, which is an anti-inflammatory cytokine. So this means the whole system, pro-inflammation and anti-inflammation, is more activated during the depressed state. To make very shortly the things a bit even more complicated, I have to introduce this tryptophan-kynurenine metabolism. You know that tryptophan is an amino acid which is degraded to serotonin, which has to do, of course, with depression, as we all know, and also to melatonin. And there is this enzyme EDIDO, which reacts to an immune activation. So if there's an immune activation, then there's an increase of the IDO and an increase to this to the arm of the quinolinic acid, which plays a role in depression. Quinolinic acid is a neurotoxic compound, and it is an agonist in the glutamatergic neurotransmission, an NMDA receptor agonist. That means if there is a increase in inflammatory system, then, and this is one of the findings you can see here, the ratio between the 3-hydroxyquinurinine and the quinurinine, this neurotoxic pathway is more activated in the patients in the depressed patients compared to controls. That means here the 3-hydroxyquinurinine is also neurotoxic, and it is more, this neurotoxic arm is built during this inflammatory activation in major depressed patients. And what we also found was a relationship between, a significant relationship between the interleukin 6 levels and the stress scales, both the LTE scale and the PSS scale, not only in the depressed patients, but all in the whole group, also in the controls, you can see the relationship between the immune activation and the stress. What we also found is a lower anti-inflammatory activity in the depressed patients, and also a relationship between the interleukin 6 and the childhood trauma. This has also been shown by other groups before, but this is a kind of reproduction of the results, that there's a significant relationship between the childhood trauma and the interleukin 6, that means the immune activation. Also in depression, we and other groups did studies with the anti-inflammatory medication, especially with the celecoxib. I don't want to go here into details, but also show only the meta-analysis that this anti-inflammatory medication has also an effect in depression. This meta-analysis has been performed by a group from Korea, but this is another meta-analysis by a group from Denmark. Also, they found altogether that there is an antidepressive effect of the anti-inflammatory treatment. I don't want to go here into more details. We have heard before that, of course, there is a strong interaction, especially during stress, with the immune system and the glucocorticoid system. We know that the glucocorticoid system is also activated, an activation of the HPA axis, but interestingly, the results are very confusing. Sometimes we find after an inflammatory stimulus a high glucocorticoid response very quickly. Others found find a glucocorticoid response also in animal models only after a longer time. So the relationship between the HPA axis and the immune system seems not to be so clear and so strong as we and all the other groups always thought. So let me shortly summarize. The influence of stress on infections and on autoimmune disorders is well known since decades. Stress is associated with an activation of the inflammatory system. In the meantime, the vulnerability stress and possibly also inflammation models of schizophrenia and of depression are widely accepted. Stress is associated with an increased risk for schizophrenia and for depression. In depression, the role of early life stress, of childhood traumata, is a hot topic currently. Own studies confirm the relationship between stress, childhood trauma, inflammation, and also these neurotoxic metabolites of the kynurenine system and depression. The inflammation during pregnancy of the mother and prepubertal stress increases the risk for schizophrenia. Anti-inflammatory medication seems to be efficient in schizophrenia and in depression. And the glucocorticoid system, of course, is an important aspect of the stress response, reacting on inflammatory signals, but the studies show no really clear results. Thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.